not trying to deflect that. Unless you want to talk about food?
No.
Because one of the things that's so interesting, when you talk about Ron's intellect and his sense of humor, his pad of choice was clear print. Did you know this?
Yes.
Yeah. And it was clear print with a little 1 millimeter grid.
Yes.
And what was really amazing to watch it, because he drew with this really finely tuned mechanical pencil. And he would start drawing. And you could watch him, but he could crack jokes while he was doing it. It was a little bit like watching Leonard Bernstein play complicated piano pieces while lecturing. You know, it was astonishing, because you would watch him drawing and you're starting to watch this incredible drawing emerge. But he's starting over in a corner and maybe a little thing over here, and then maybe something, but this perfectly calculated where it's going to go, because he's doing piping and nuclear reactors and airfoils and all sorts of things, and he knows where it should be. And he's drawing and talking while he's doing it and making all these calculations based on these little teeny grids. It's absolutely amazing.
It was all to scale, right? I mean, you could,
and it's all to scale. You can just sort of take a little tape measure and go, okay, that's how long that took. Got it.
It was almost a plan view for everything he did. It looks like a beautiful.
Yeah, he'd always start with planning automation, and then he'd do his two-face imagining. Sometimes he was really scary, just went straight back. It was really something else.
But talking about his humor, like, that was the one thing that came through. Like, even when people were talking about his influence from, like, how brilliant he was as a designer and how intelligent he was, the one thing that came up time and time again was how funny he was. The ronologues was something that kind of mentioned, like, what were, yeah, like, to Jacob's point, like, who was he as a human being?
I think the ronologues would be something fun to talk about, since that was kind of where,
like, what were the things that you, at dinner parties, like, what were the things that you would be interested in talking about? Like,
it could be anything.
Okay.
I mean, what, there certainly were very specific things that he was interested in, and we would have debates on. In fact, when you talk about going to a dinner party with him, not necessarily the big ones, because you didn't have a one-on-one with Ron as much as you would want to, but when we'd go in, and my wife and I, and we'd get there, I would study up before I got there. I literally would study up, because we would be in we would have finished the debate about sociobiology or some other kind of science debate that was going on in the culture. And I was taking one side, he was taking the other, and then we'd leave, and then I'm going to get this guy. I'd be so that's the kind of intellectual, stimulation he brought to this. He made you a better person. He made you a smarter person, because you had to kind of think it out. But somehow it all seemed like, where did he have the time to read all this and come up with it? He really did just have he was just smarter than everybody else. And he really had a take on almost everything. You know, he would have from everything, evolutionary biology, like I said, and what Jim was saying was ants, like the E.O. Wilson book, this gigantic book on ants. He pulled it open to me once. He was showing me an ant that was evolved by way of being kind of a soldier ant. And if the hive was being attacked, the ant would explode. It actually had an explosive mechanism, and he says, you know, and you could see that in, you know, like, he he was going to put that in some alien. But that's where it came from that immense curiosity he had in the sciences, in the arts, and pretty much anything. Good music?
Yeah, he did album covers. There was a really great story, I don't mean to cut you off, about he did the cover for a Jefferson Airplane album, and we heard the story when we did a panel at Comic-Con that he went to the apartment of the band to talk about the album, and he walked in and the lead singer was naked, just like in a chair, like strumming a guitar, and like talked to him about what the album cover was going to be, and Ron just sat there, I guess, completely like it was the most normal thing ever, just gleaning everything, went home and painted this like 12-foot banner that became, I don't remember the name of the album, but it's an airplane that's carrying a house with like all this stuff falling out.
I think so. It became Jefferson Starship. That was
Jefferson
the whole
Starship.
Thing.
Yes,
was,
they were changing their name.
And that's ultimately what led to Dan O'Bannon to share. If, yeah, if someone has a story about one they want to share. Well,
yeah. Number one, I work with Ron off and on with these guys that are talking about the future.
He needs the mic.
Oh,
the mic that doesn't work.
I don't talk that loud. That's right. But he, when the internet came on, he showed me this cartoon. And it was the very early days of the internet. And it was a picture of God in the clouds. And he's sitting there in front of a computer. He's like this, and he's looking at the computer. And the caption is, "You've got prayers." So you pick up on, you know, stuff that was happening right away until immediately. So you could have that.
Did you know that he had a small role in Conan the Barbarian?
No.
Yeah, he's in the town. Is he selling lizard on a stick? Isn't that what it is?
Oh yeah.
Lizard on a stick, yeah.
He's also in tea, right?
He and Mitch. Yeah, he and Mitch are the two guys who walk in and go, you know, they dutifully are carrying the coffin in, and they put E.T. in the coffin, and then they leave and close it down, and he's got that wrong, you know. Very serious.
Serious is a good one.
Very serious one.
There is the impish Ron Cobb.
I worked with Ron at the View on Cats and Dogs.
Oh, no kidding.
Remember me. Ron and our tables were facing each other, and Ron would stay really quiet for the longest time, and then he would say these random things without looking up, checking on me to make sure I was using the right tools. He couldn't see anything. He goes, "I think you should switch to your pen now, because you're barking." You can see what I'm doing. But I thought it for a while. I was looking around looking for cameras or somehow he knew. It was,
he liked the best of you.
Yeah, my wife worked with him on Robojocks.
Oh, really?
Yeah, a long time ago.
I heard multiple stories about people saying the same things, where he would like be working and then be like, "Well, I guess I'll just die." Like, it was like the most random. Like, he would be in the middle of painting and then just be like, say
I'd
something.
I'd start to get really stressed, like I was being watched. And he was over there, and there's no way that you could see
what you were doing.
Yeah, and he probably tuned in right on it and said, "Well, I'm really getting this guy." That's fun.
Yeah.
Were you with him when he was doing the control, the unfolding control thing, or?
Yeah, I was doing the doghouse control panels, the doghouse inside, and I think we're kind of working on the same thing, but he was working on the stuff that was coming out of the ground, out of the gardens, and we were kind of bouncing back and forth.
It's a weird challenge.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out how can I go there and steal one of his sketches. There was just no opportunity.
Well, we did three shows in a row right then. You got him in the book, because we did Six Days, where he did that brilliant design for this.
Helicopter.
But, I mean, it was so brilliant. You've got to look at this design. It's great. It sort of has these big wings in it, but it folds it back. It's a helicopter fuselage, and then it turns into a helicopter. But as it goes up, it had enough air lift on the fan blades, so that as the jet engines started going forward, it would slowly auto-rotate to a standstill and then go into a full wing position and then a swept back position and take off and go flying really fast. Because he was on the Martin Marietta Future of Aviation panel for a couple of years, right?
Of course he was.
Yeah, no, he was. I mean, it's a guy that was, you know, high school education. He's on the Future of Aviation in Martin Marietta, and he's, you know, it's like...
He was in they had called Steven Spielberg in to do something with NASA, and he sat in, I guess, like 5 minutes and was like, "You need to call Ron Cobb. Like, I don't know what you guys are talking about. Like, I love all of this stuff, but if you want someone who's going to be able to bounce back with you, call Ron," and they did, and that was what Robin was referring to. He got to go out and watch Space Launch, and he actually did a painting of the launch, and also that one, and then the when the rocket came back down, he did another painting, and both of those are in the Smithsonian.
You had a question.
At the end of the book, you have a section in which you show us drawings for the FCS. How much work did he do with that?
that's the Future Combat System.
Yes.
He did a lot. I mean, he was at the Institute 4 years, 5 years. I mean, it was a long time. But it's what's in the book kind of just barely scratches the surface of what he did. But and we were talking about this, say backstage in the green room. But he was using a lot of what he was design elements that he was introducing in Aliens, which were these ideas of modular tanks, where you could kind of take the chassis of the tank and then retrofit something on top of it, and you could use it for like an armored tank, or if you wanted something with heavy artillery, and you'd be able to just use this the tank chassis and swap out almost like an action figure what the top of that would be. And so he took a lot of the sci-fi stuff that he was doing, whether it was for Aliens or True Lies, and was trying to turn it into actual stuff that could be used by the military. None of it got made, and in fact, what I was told from the head of the guy that was running the Future Combat System was what they ran into was that they were, the next war they said was not going to be a ground war, and what Ron was designing was stuff to replace infantry soldiers, and it was probably going to be something in the water, and Ron wasn't designing water vehicles, so he was designing these spaceships and airplanes and robots or exoskeletons to replace human soldiers, and so they were just kind of like, we're not going to build these multi-billion-dollar vehicles.
But this was 2001, right?
Yeah, this was 2000. Yeah.
Because when he talked to me about it, he said he didn't really like any of the designs he was coming up with. But the original thing really appealed to him because he got drawn into it by John Milius.
Okay.
The military went to Milius first. And what had happened was the military felt like 9/11 got flat for them. And so they wanted to use Hollywood imagination to sort of just keep brainstorming different out there scenarios that none of their military strategists could come up with.
Right.
And that part was really exciting.
Right.
But then when it started devolving into, but now it gave us a piece of hardware.
Right, like actual world.
That stuff wasn't, I think we got bored with that a bit.
And the PowerPoints they would show were very Hollywoodized. I mean, they were basically trying to create scenarios of a Hollywood movie.
They were making movies using Ron's tech. Like, there's keyframes.
Yeah.
Like, there's keyframe illustrations of movies basically trying to sell this idea of the future of the U.S. military.
And they wanted to bring Milius in for that, the directing, like the storytelling component, as like a writer to build out these stories of what, you know, these fictitious war events would be. But yeah, it seems like something that would happen in 2022 of like, let's hire a bunch of Hollywood people to figure out how to fight the next war. And
give them some aspirin.
Give them some aspirin. A bottle of wine.
Yeah.
Did anyone else have any other questions? Or do you want to speak? You're nodding your head. I don't know if you have a question. No? Yeah.
I wanted to, I'm curious about just homages. So I'm finding out about Ron much later than everyone probably, but I'm working my way back, right? And so I think that the first hint of Ron's significance for me came when I found out that Chris Nolan named the protagonist in Inception after Ron. So his name is Leonardo DiCaprio's name is Dom Cobb. But it's actually paying tribute to Ron Cobb, right? And on the surface, it seems like, oh, that's cool. That's tribute, right? But the subject matter of Inception, not to get too deep into that, but the subject matter of Inception is largely about empathy and design. Mm-hmm. They're architects for dream worlds, and they have to empathize with whoever they're performing a heist on, right? They have to think about that person's psychology and their deepest fears. And like, for example, Killian Murphy, I don't know if you guys know this. Killian Murphy, a huge plot point is Killian Murphy's relationship with his dad. So they actually have to build a building in the snow just to get inside that guy's mind. And one of the things, I teach a Designing the Story World class to teens, and one of the things we focus a lot on, a recurring theme, is empathy. And I find that even as I hear you guys speak about Ron, I find that, okay, he has a high level of curiosity and a high level of empathy, and kind of working together to create not just cool looking ships, but things that serve the inhabitants, that serve the characters in the story. and I'm fascinated by that. So I was just thinking about all that to go into like what other tributes in cinema have been played. I love hearing the story about the cameo in Conan, but I'm curious if there's any other tributes in cinema that have been made for like towards Ron.
There is a one, and this is, and y'all forgive me because it's a very complicated one, but Ron designed a few of the characters in Star Wars for the cantina scene, some of the aliens, and one of them specifically, this hammerhead shaped alien that I'm sure if you saw it, this is very, you know, specific. It was such a popular character, even though in the scene it's very ancillary, it's kind of in the background. They actually built it out in the canon, and its last name ended up becoming Cobb. I don't remember its first name, but this alien had a whole life of its own in the comic books and in the cartoons, and it actually had the last name Cobb. And,
it's in the Boba Fett series. And
yeah,
it's
yeah.
A big part.
Oh, I have not seen the Boba Fett series, but I know that they did that as a tribute to Ron. And,
you know, I would say one thing is that in my, I didn't work with Ron many times, but in the time, you'd think that this would be kind of the norm, but he always made for an incredibly positive design experience. You know, he made going to work enjoyable, made it fun that you go and get to hang out with these guys, and Tim did that as well. There's certain people, and it seems like that would be a no-brainer, but trust me when I say I've worked with people that aren't really all that great, you know? And you get a few of those. And when you do get a few of those, then it makes those other people that much better. And working with him was always like, I have to get to sit next to him and we joke. And when you get to work with someone like that, you really appreciate that. Very grateful for that.
I had a question just to wrap up. You had a great quote in the book about Ron's influence on science fiction from the production design standpoint. So many films as a production designer, but from what you've seen working with up and coming artists, you know, in the way that they've used Ron's influence unconsciously, if you could just speak to that a little bit of what you've seen as a production designer in, you know, these artists who are coming into the industry nowadays and are not aware of what he's contributed to the world of science fiction design.
Well, it's I think what Nick was pointing out, which is you know, like the design for the alien ship almost made it blue collar. Made it very relatable. It's a shame that it's sort of become a trope. You know, it's almost like they all have to look like that. And I see it sort of in a lot, you know, when I go looking at people's portfolios and everything else, I keep looking at it and go, well, so I guess you know Ron Cobb's work, and they go, incredibly. And it's a shame because this generation should be aware of exactly how that came about. And I have to say, it doesn't look like Ron's work, but he profoundly affected me on Midnight Sky, which was a picture I designed two or three years ago. And the spaceship on that, when it was supposed to be able to fly to Jupiter and back, you know, almost 4 years in space. So I said, I'm going to make it a Ron Cobb spaceship that doesn't look like a Ron Cobb spaceship. And that was the gauntlet I threw down for myself. And I thought about Ron every day on what he would do and how you would really address the problems that go unaddressed in most space movies. I'm going to address gravity. I'm going to address the fact that if you really wanted to do a vertical Ron gravity wheel, it would be the gross national product for the United States for 10 years just to get all that shit up in space. And so I started really trying to find out how you would design a viable spaceship that could transport people back and forth. And it was always about Ron. It was because even if I came up with the design, it was how do you make it relatable? How do you get people to look at it and say, that makes sense? I don't know whether I succeeded or not. But I thought about Ron constantly, and I thought about all of our lunches together and all of our time together, and just thought, it was a profound influence on me. And I think in a way, when I introduce other people to his work, the work is fantastic. You look at it, you can look at his perspectives on politics, on sociology, on just about everything, but it's the way he did try to get a complete view of what was going on. He really, really wanted to understand everything. He was so curious about everything. That's what you wanted. And and to make that exploration of a dramatic idea really fun.
Yeah, I mean that's what we're hoping with the book, that the book is not just it's a legacy to Ron and his work, but also for like future generations that are working currently and are designing to maybe have a approach their design in a different way rather than just visual, because I think it's so easy now for designers and artists to just download a bunch of art. And I say this, I'm married to a concept artist, so there's no shade there. I love concept artists, I'm very pro concept artists. But in terms of like the design sensibilities on the way problems can be attacked, looking at the way that Ron designed things, not just focusing on the visuals, like does this thing work? So that's really what we're hoping with the book, is that teaching people who Ron was, but also educating like upcoming artists on other way, different sensibilities for design, which is what he was so brilliant at.
You could say if you're successful, if they make toys out of your stuff.
I just work on my master's in the universe.
Oh, yeah.
That's the other way around.
It's all toys. Well, thank you all so much for being here.
The book is a wealth of not only Hollywood stuff, it also goes into his days in the LA Free Press, his famous Monsters of Magazine, famous Monsters of Filmland magazine covers, album covers, and stuff he did for video games. He had started a video game, part of a group that started a video game company called Rocket Science Games, that weirdly enough Elon Musk was the intern for.
Forrest Gump of the concept art world. Yeah. He's been everywhere.
Been everywhere. But yeah, he was there. Elon was their coffee guy. Like 2002 or something, 2003. Wanted to say thank you and to the people who put the book together, who helped get all these interviews together. Thank you guys.
We started our organization to help get more artists into the history books, and then after 3 years, we're like, okay, I guess we just have to make some books. So this will hopefully be the first of many highlighting artists that the world needs to know their names. But now, full signing portion.
Yeah, if you guys want to come up and sign your book.